reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise.
And welcome to TBC today. It is so wonderful to see so many visitors. You are really, really welcome today. And it's also really lovely to see some of our church family back for the first time. And it's absolutely fantastic to see you as well. I'm so glad that you did that just before I gave out who I was, because I would have suddenly felt my ego go through the wall, and that would not have been good. My name's Astrid. I'm one of the ministers here. Please do not applaud. That's brilliant. I know we've got lots of visitors here today, which is wonderful. One of the things that we have as a way of trying to encourage people to stay connected with us is a Connect form. We've not got the paper copies out at the moment, but if you'd like a paper copy to complete, please let me know. What we'd love you to do, though, is to go to our website, which is Thornhill thornhillbc.org.uk. Just Google Thornhill Baptist Church and go down to the hub part of our website, and that way you can fill out a connect form, and that means that we will send you regular emails to let you know what we're doing and so on. We'd love to connect with you. We also want to say welcome this morning, as well as to all of you who are here in the room, to our friends and our church family who are worshipping online today and will have tuned in from home. Guys, you are also really, really welcome to join in our baptism service this morning. So let's pray together. Father, we are so excited at what you have done in our lives, all of our lives, especially though the lives of those who are being baptized today. But as we come together and we feel the buzz in this room and the presence of your Holy Spirit, Father, I pray that this morning you would build our faith. Lord, you would grow our expectation of what you're going to do in our individual and in our collective community lives together. Father, as we hear testimony and as we worship you, I pray that you will deepen our trust in you, the God of the universe, Almighty Lord. Father, I pray that you will enlarge our hope. It has been such a challenging season that we are still kind of wobbling through. But God, you are our hope. Jesus, you are our hope. Holy Spirit, you quicken our spirits and you give us hope. Enlarge our hope today. Strengthen our relationship with you. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to stand and we're going to worship now. So let's enjoy. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. Thank you. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, God. You do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive, break every chain. Oh God, you have done great. You have done great things. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God, above it all.
Let's just pause and stay in that moment. You've been faithful through every storm. Let's pause and remember God's faithfulness to us. And he set us free to dance in his freedom, awake and alive. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Do feel free to take your seats, but don't take them anywhere. We are so excited that we have three people who are going to be baptized. And I'm going to give you a little bit of an explanation as to what happens when we're baptized. And while I'm giving a little introduction to this, Val, in a few moments, I'd just ask you to go and collect our young people and our children. And parents, in a couple of moments, maybe when you see Val vanish, I wonder whether parents of creche children, I wonder whether you'd go and collect your children and bring them back so that they can sit with you just during this part of the service. The children, the older children, unless they want to sit with you as parents, will sit up out of camera shot on the platform there. So what is baptism all about? This is something that we're going to witness today, and it's an outward sign of something that has gone on the inside of those who were being baptized. In the Bible, a man called John baptized people who turned away from a bad way of living. They said sorry to God, and they started to follow God's ways. And you may have heard of this as being called repenting of your sins. When somebody is baptized, they're saying sorry to God. They're recognizing that they can't live a life which pleases God without his help. And they symbolize this by going under the water. They're turning their back on an old way of living, and they're turning their face to a new way of living by coming out of the water. Sometimes we describe the pool as being a bit like a grave, dying to an old way of life and coming out of the water, resurrecting, as it were, to a new way of life. But Jesus was also baptized, not because he'd done anything wrong, but baptism started his ministry of teaching people about who he was and why they needed to know him. So baptism reminds us that God has a purpose for each and every one of us when we give our lives over to following Jesus. It reminds us of who Jesus is, what he's done for us. And then when Jesus came out of the water at his baptism, God says, "This is my son. I'm very pleased with him." It was a good thing for Jesus to do. And so it's a good thing for us also. We're baptized out of obedience to God. It's a special time of God being with us. It's a blessing. And so God is really especially pleased with those who are being baptized this morning, Bradley, Marcel, and Hannah. He's smiling on you today. He is that delighted in you. In a few moments, both Bradley and Marcel and Hannah are going to tell us about their experience of following Jesus. Now, if you don't know Jesus, or you know Jesus but you've never been baptized, sometimes we feel a little bit emotional as we hear stories and as we witness what is going on in that pool. But don't worry if you do. It just means that God is here and he's doing something. He's talking to you in some kind of way. So have a chat with Bradley or Marcel or Hannah at the end of the service, or any one of us that have been involved in today, if you want to talk about what went on within you as you witnessed this baptism. It's also our practice here that after we've had the splash moment, after they've gone down into the water and they've come back up again, and you will, we have a pause. And that's the opportunity for each and every one of us in this room to ask God whether there is anything that he would like to say to encourage Bradley, Marcel, or Hannah. You might find that God brings a Bible verse to you, or maybe you see a picture that you think would be an encouragement. You see something in your mind, or you just get a sense that God wants you to say something of encouragement to them. Can I encourage you, if you feel that stirring, to speak it out, and to speak it out in as clear a voice as you feel brave enough to do? If you don't feel brave enough to speak it out loud, see if you're sitting next to somebody that would feel brave enough to say it on your behalf. Because it's fantastic to know that God is going to speak to you and be part of Bradley and Marcel's and Hannah's baptism, because he's using you to speak some words of encouragement to them. We have people in the congregation who are frantically going to be scribbling down what they hear, and that's why it's really helpful if you speak loudly. They'll be able to capture that, and then that will be given to Bradley and Marcel and Hannah later in the week. So, welcome, youngsters. We are waiting for Extreme to come through. So, Transform. This is Extreme. I'm so sorry. Do you know, I'm just not one of the people that do kids work and youth work, and so I always get the names muddled. So forgive me, Ellen. I'm so sorry. We'll just wait for our youngsters to come through. While I'm here, just children, I know as you came in, you might have not heard everything I said, but when Bradley and Marcel and Hannah go into the water and get wet when they're baptized, and I know Ella's explained everything that's going to happen today, you might feel that God speaks to you and you've got something that you'd like to say to them, to encourage them. If it feels too big to say it to them because of all the other people in the room, can I encourage you to let Ellen or let Gwen know, and they'll speak it out for you, all right? Because I absolutely believe that God loves speaking through our children as well as through the very oldest person that's in this room. So while we're waiting, Bradley and Marcel, would you like to come and join me up here on the platform? What we're going to do, we're going to baptize Bradley and Marcel kind of together, because it's really lovely. They're husband and wife, and it's great to be able to do that. And then we're going to sing some songs that they've chosen, and then we're going to invite Hannah up here as well. So, both Marcel and Bradley have structured their testimonies in the form of three questions. So I'm going to ask those questions, and Marcel has asked me to read out her testimony, and then Bradley's going to share his. So the first question, how and when did you become a Christian, Marcel? Marcel says, I grew up in a Christian family. As a child, my parents took me to church on Sunday. One of my happiest childhood memories is of my sisters and I attending Sunday school, which I enjoyed, and it's also where we learned about all the Bible stories. It was this that set the grounding and helped me to accept what Jesus has done for me and what he is still doing for me in my life. I also believe that Jesus died for my sins. So the next question that we asked Marcel was, what difference has your faith made to your life? And she said, I know life can be challenging at times, especially when you feel alone. Having faith in my life has made a difference because I strongly believe when in dark times I can reach out, talk by praying to God who will listen and answer my prayers. One example of this: while for the first time in my life I was away from my family, I prayed to God for a daughter. And now when I look back on that prayer, I'm so thankful because I've been blessed with two healthy daughters. My faith ensures that I am blessed. I feel God helps me to be strong and keeps me doing the best I can. For this I am truly thankful. And then of course the final question was, why have you decided to be baptized now? And Marcel has said, I've chosen to be baptized now because I feel this is the right time. I feel I want to be close to God as he keeps blessing me day after day. I want to be right with God while I teach my girls about God's love so they can also see his blessings. So thank you so much. It is brave. It's brave to stand up here. Can I just invite you to encourage Marcel? Bradley, I'm going to ask you those same questions, and I think you're going to answer them.
Yes,
but I'm going to get you to stand at the microphone if I can, so that we can all hear you. All right. That's brilliant. So, Bradley, how and when did you become a Christian?
I didn't really know how to answer the question, but because Marcel and I worked together, I guess the earliest memory I can remember from church was going to church with my grandmom, similar to what my kids are doing, and she'd hand out coins, some offerings, so we'd all drop our little bit into the church, and that was, I guess, one of my fondest memories of church as a child. I'll change the next bit, Astrid, so you probably Most recently on the Alpha course, I started focusing and listening or concentrating on God and my faith. And I guess for some of you that have seen me through this year would know the troubles that I've faced. And most recently was this weekend where I went back to work. I sat next to somebody, suspected COVID, so I wasn't sure if it was coming today. So up until yesterday, we got the results. Even driving down now was the text, everything's clear. So right through the whole year, there's been a block, a block, a block, a block, a block. So I guess also on the course, one of the biggest take homes for me was the sacrifice that Jesus made for myself, for all of us. And I think I mentioned it to Stacey, just the pain. We talk about mental health and how, I guess, my little thing is coming down now and all the anxiety that I had. But the night before the crucifixion, he knew everything. And the sheer power that he had to just carry on and be peaceful at it was something that really resonated with me. Brilliant. I guess that's one reason I'm here today.
Brilliant. So are there any other aspects that you'd like to talk through as to how your faith has made a difference in your life?
So I guess it's true, I guess my life as a Christian, there's always been little moments where I felt I should turn away from, the way I was living and come back to church where we grew up. Just before the Alpha course, I started reading like audiobooks, and most of them were like self-help books and just encouraging books, how to do better. Most of them were self-improvement via I love myself, I can reach for the sky, always I can, I can, I can, I can. So through the Alpha course, God, not Alpha course, both the Alpha course and the First Steps course, it's reliance on God. So it's not only I can do it, but God is helping me do it. God is helping me stand here. God is helping me talk to all of you. I couldn't do it by myself. God put all the stars in the sky. He put me here, and none of us can do it without him. Mm. So I guess that's another big take home I took. Regardless of who you think you are, I am doesn't work. It's we are, he is. That's one of the biggest changes in my life.
That's brilliant. Yeah. So why have you decided to be baptized now?
I don't know if I so I wrote down, looking back at my life, there's always been the opportunity or calling to do to be baptized. I sat in an audience just like this, in fact somewhere down here, one of the baptisms a few years ago. And through the baptism, it was a call. Anybody feels like going to be baptized. I nearly stood up and nearly went. Mm. It's happened to me about 3 or 4 times in my life. I just didn't do it. Didn't feel ready, didn't feel the need or the urge to step up in front of everybody. There's loads of things. If I get wet, what happens now? All that other stuff started playing in my head. So I just never did it. I guess not only through the Alpha course, but it's when I had kids. One of the biggest things any father would say is, I'm never ready for children. Regardless of how prepared you are, you've been saving for years, you're never ready until the babies come. And that's how I felt. So when the courses asked, what are you waiting for? Why are you not getting baptized? I didn't have an answer. There's no answer. I've seen the blessings that come with the children. Mm-hmm. So here, I might as well stand up and take it. Mm-hmm. Accept. And then also because of the pain that I felt Jesus went through, I felt guilty. I need saving. He has saved me. And I'd just like to do the right thing by him and stand up for him too.
Fantastic. Well, we're so glad that this is the moment where you've both said yes. So I'm going to invite you to go over to the pool and prepare. Well done, both of you. Well done.
Thank you. however warm you think it's going to be, it's a little bit warmer than that.
Oh, yes!
Just baptised myself.
So long ago, I forgot how many steps there were.
Yes, of course you can, yeah.
Marcel, do you acknowledge Jesus Christ as your Saviour and Lord?
Yes.
And with the help of the Holy Spirit, do you promise to serve Jesus Christ in the church and in the world to your life's end?
Yes.
Upon a profession of your faith and at your own request, we gladly baptise you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. We're going to pray for you now, so that's not a microphone, so it's just between us. Something we want to pray that you would send your Holy Spirit onto Marcel now. Amen. We want to pray that you would flow through her in a new and deeper way, that you would empower her and fill her, that in a new way she would know your presence with her. Amen. Each day as she wakes up through the day, in every situation that you put her in, that she would know your strength with her, that she would know your power with her, that she would know with a certainty the truth of what she believes. Lord, I pray that in any times where she comes under attack, any times when she feels any doubts, that she would be able to look back at this day and know that she knows Jesus with an absolute certainty. So Holy Spirit, fill her, we ask in Jesus' name. Release new gifts.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Now for Marcel, then please do share them now.
Marcel, as I was praying for you this week, the Lord gave me a picture of a mountain. Your life will have many ups and downs, but keep faith and continue on. And when you reach the summit, you will see the land of milk and honey stretched out before you. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst.
Thank you.
Marcel, I have a verse for you from Isaiah chapter 41. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. You may sometimes feel isolated, but Jesus is with you. Trust him, talk to him as you begin this new phase of your life, having been baptized. You will be able to share your faith with Bradley, praying together over your daily problems and about where to live and finding the right church for your spiritual home. Also for wisdom as you bring up Azaria and Alessia to know Jesus too. We pray for God's continual blessing over you and that he'll bring other Christian friends into your life very soon. And just two more verses which I feel like for both you and Bradley from Philippians. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Bless you.
Amen.
Amen.
Before Marcel leaves the water, does anybody else have any words or pictures that they'd like to share with her?
I do.
Thank you, Ellen.
Had verses from the armour of God, and it is, therefore, put on every piece of God's armour, so that you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armour of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news, so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all of these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet, and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God.
Amen.
I have 2 John 1:1-3. To the lady chosen by God, and to the children whom I love in the truth, and not only, but also all the world of truth, because of the truth which lives in us and will be with us forever. Grace, peace, and mercy from God the Father and from Jesus Christ the Lord be with you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Lovely. Bradley, it's time for you.
So Bradley, it was wonderful to hear your testimony, and we just want to ask you a couple of questions before we baptise you. Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
And are you trusting him as your Lord and Saviour?
Yes.
And have you chosen to turn from all your sin and to serve Jesus in the church and in the world?
Yes.
That's fantastic. Having heard your testimony and at your own request, it's our great pleasure to baptise you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Again, if I can invite you to share any pictures, words, or Bible verses that you have for Bradley.
Bradley, as I prayed for you this week, the Lord gave me a word for you from Ecclesiastes 3:1-2. To everything there is a season and a time, to every purpose under the heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. Praise God for you.
Amen. Some words come to me from Philippians 1, I think it's verse 6, that God, who has begun a good work in you, will continue it until the coming, the return of Jesus Christ, when he will complete it.
To Bradley and
that's fantastic.
Straight
hand. And as a warrior, and a messiah, hold tight to your faith. The faith you have, and may God soon lead you to Christian friends, so you can find support through them. We pray for God's continued blessing over you and your family in the coming days. And I repeat the verses from Philippians that I read to myself. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Bless you too, Daddy.
Thank you.
Bradley, I have a message for you and myself. You are known by God, you are known by God.
Yes,
I feel so emotional today, and I didn't expect to feel this emotional. And I'm drawn in on what Ashley has said about how the Lord sometimes brings us in our bodies what the Lord is saying to both of you. And the Lord knows you both on your own. The Lord is so happy that you've taken this step together. There's been many times when you've had the opportunity to take a step, but today you've stood up and declared who the Lord is in your life. What the message is now is about the planting. You have both been planted. So my word for you now comes from the parable of the sower. Keep planted. Keep sharing anyone's anxieties and concerns together and take them to the Lord. Take your petitions to the Lord. Don't lean on your own understanding. That is amazing. And put on every piece of armour. And when you feel not too great, shield up tall. Ask God for a bigger shield so that your whole body is protected, so not one arrow will hit you when the enemy comes. In the name of Jesus, I love you guys.
Thank you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for having me. Amen.
Thank you.
I have
a message
for you.
I wanted to share something that I think God's saying. I think it's really significant that the two of you have been baptised together. And I believe that God wants to put a blessing on your household and your family. You haven't just committed yourselves as two individuals to a life of faith. You've committed yourselves as a family to a life of faith. And I believe that God is going to make your household a place that other people sense hope when they walk in, where they sense his presence as they walk in. You two girls, God doesn't just love your mum and dad, he absolutely adores you. And you're going to get to know him better and better as you grow up. But there's going to be something really special in your household. As people walk in, they're going to sense God's presence there.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to sing two songs now that Bradley and Marcel have chosen. And actually, they're songs that their children, their girls, love singing. And they want these two songs, when the girls sing them, to remind them of what's taken place today. So let's, as we sing these songs, actually pray something of what Paul has just shared over their household. Let's stand and sing together.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day the Lord hath made. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Jesus gave it to me, I'm gonna let it shine. Jesus gave it to me, I'm gonna let it shine. Jesus gave it to me, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Brilliant, that's absolutely great. Hannah, come and join me up here. Please do take a seat. Hannah, the microphone's yours. Looking forward to your testimony. Thank you.
Hello. So, as I'm sure a lot of you know, I've grown up in a Christian family and I've been part of the TVC family all my life. And I certainly wouldn't be who I am today if it weren't for all of you lovely people. So shout out to all of you, whether you've led a group that I've been part of or just been a friendly face. You've all been such an encouragement to my faith, and I'm really, really grateful for that. In all honesty, my life hasn't been filled with all these super dramatic Holy Spirit moments and physical encounters with God, but instead more powerful internal reminders and realizations of God's love, just when I've been worshipping or praying or chatting with other people. So in that way, I guess it's hard to pinpoint many exact moments in my journey of faith that have shaped me. But obviously one very significant point would be when I became a Christian. So, like I said, I've grown up in church and kind of always known Jesus. But I made the decision to commit my life to him in 2017 at Soul Survivor, which is one of the Christian youth festivals that we've been to as a church. And it was at these camps that have been some of the times that I felt God's presence most intensely. Because there's something about being surrounded by 8,500 other young Christians that makes you realise quite how active and present God really is. Seeing God healing people and setting them free is the most incredible and awe-inspiring thing. And in those times of worship, have been some of the times I've just felt so filled with the Holy Spirit and empowered to share this. However, it hasn't just been at these big youth festivals that I felt God's presence. To be honest, the times when I feel most vulnerable with God have been the times when I'm just alone in my room listening to worship music. And to me, this really just goes to show that God is present wherever you are, whether you're surrounded by other Christians or completely by yourself. He's there. As every Christian knows, living a life for Jesus isn't full of only these mountaintop moments. And there have definitely been times when I felt really challenged in my faith, particularly being a Christian in a school and college that is predominantly made up of non-Christians. However, these challenging times have also been the times that I felt the most noticeable answers to prayer. Because I remember a few times coming home from college and just feeling so low about my faith because of really hard conversations that I've had with people and almost crying out to God, asking him where he was in the conversations I was having. And then the next day I would have the same conversation with the same person and it would just be a lot more constructive, I guess. So yeah, there have been plenty of times when I felt distant from God. That's a normal thing. But I found a lot of truth in what it says in James when he writes, "Consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance." And here I am today. There have been ups and downs in my journey, but I'm excited to see where God leads me, both in the coming months as the intern here, but also in my life as a whole. And my faith means trusting in God wherever I am, whether I'm in the top of a mountain or in the depths of a dark valley, like, and knowing that he is there through it all. I'm getting baptized because I just love Jesus so much. And I want to show this to the world. And I want to equip myself to serve him and make his love known all around. Because God is so, so good. And he really does transform lives. So yay for him.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Do you want to go over there? Yeah, of course. That's great. Just while Hannah makes her way to the baptismal pool, I love the shout outs for our Alpha team, for our First Step teams, and for all of our youth and children's and other groups, because actually it often takes a community to bring somebody to faith.
Right. Take a moment to get your breath. Hannah, I was the minister here of the church where Mum and Dad dedicated you to God, so it's a joy and a privilege for me today to share in your baptism. Hannah, do you acknowledge Jesus Christ as your Saviour and Lord?
I do.
And with the help of the Holy Spirit, do you promise to serve him in the church and in the world to your life's end?
I do.
Hannah, upon a profession of your faith and at your own request, we gladly baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I'm just going to pray for you before people pray. I want to thank you so much for the way we have seen you at work in Hannah's life, for the way that she has grown in her faith, for the way that she has grown as a person, and for the compassion that you've put in her towards other people. Lord, that she is such a reflection of your heart, of your gentleness, of your kindness, of your loving nature towards others. And Lord, I want to pray that from today there will be a new sense of your presence with her, a new sense of fullness of your Spirit. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would fill her afresh in her body, in her mind, in her spirit, in every moment of every day, that she would know your presence with her, that you would release her gifts, that you would lead her into new places where her heart is stretched and challenged, and she finds that you come through for her. Lord, I pray that you would take her to new depths of faith. And Lord, that she would just know that there
Again, if I can encourage you to share words and pictures for Hannah, Bible verses, that would be wonderful.
That's Hannah. I saw this in the book and I felt that I should come and carry it on you. The visual spirit seems to come through, you know it well in the NIV. This is in the Passion Translation, so this is what they're going to do for you. And I pray that if you have a faith within you, the unlimited riches of his glory and favour, the supernatural strength flood to your innermost being, of his divine might and his closest power. Then by constantly using your faith, the life of Christ will be living spirit within you. And the rest of the love will become the very source of the root of your life. Then you will be empowered to discover what every Holy One experiences, the great magnitude of the astonishing love of Christ in the expanding of you. Having through intimate, sorry, and falling into his love, having you really considered endless love for your pleasures that transcends our understanding. This expanding love falls into you. It has not failed to overflow in the fullness of God. Let it be the world.
I kind of like to say something to Hannah because I know you, but when I first met you, I was like, wow, Hannah is such, you have such a deep connection with God that I always wanted to be a Christian because I put that much kind of faith and commitment to God like you do. And now I'm just getting, when I kind of get baptized like this. Well, I have an image which I've seen a couple of times recently in this book. And when you were saying your piece just then earlier, I felt that it cut. I think it relates to you. So I think it's a white horse. I don't know what it means. I don't know anything about it, but it's a white horse.
Hannah, as I prayed for you this week, the Lord gave me these words for you. I will be your refuge. I will be your fortress. Trust in me. I will deliver you from the snare. I will cover you with my feathers, and under my wings you will trust. You will not be afraid day or night. Every step you take, the Lord will be with you. You are his delight.
Some verses from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. For it is not ourselves that we preach. We preach Jesus Christ as our Lord, ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. The God who said, out of the darkness the light shall shine, is the same God who made his light shine in our hearts, to bring us the knowledge of God's glory shining in the face of Christ. Yet we have this spiritual treasure, and they are like common day pots. In order to show that the supreme power belongs to God, not to us. We are often troubled, but not crushed. Sometimes in doubt, but never in despair. There are many enemies, but we are never without a friend. And they badly hurt at times, we are not destroyed.
Father, Ecclesiastes 12, verse 9 says, young people, enjoy your youth and be happy while you are still young. Do what you want to do and follow your heart's desire. But remember that God is going to judge you for whatever you do.
It's been such a joy watching you grow up as part of the fellowship here. And this verse just seemed right for you and your smiley face. Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And the verse that came to me that I wanted to share with you, and I'm going to have to look it up and get the exact reference, but I'm pretty sure it's from 1 Thessalonians 1. It's a very short verse. It talks about your faith having run out. And the picture is actually this. It's ripples going out. And I believe that this, your faith is going to be one that ripples out and affects others and leads others closer to Jesus.
Hannah, I just wanted to say how wonderful and what a joy it is to be here with you. Your words that you were given in the end of your testimony just demonstrates to me just how mature you are as a Christian already at such a young age. So don't ever let anyone look at your age, because things have been unveiled already for you. We know that there's going to be times of tough journeys, but remember that love is patient and kind.
So, Hannah, when I was thinking about you this morning, I just had the words of the song, How Great Thou Art, going on and on in my mind. And the first verse of that is, O Lord my God, when I am awesome wonder, consider all the works I have done made. And I really feel that that's the way you see God in all that awesome wonder, and I think you're wonderful, and I think that God, well, I know that God loves you, but I just think the words of that song are for you, so I hope you can read it at some point, because it's quite long, I don't
know. I've got a couple of verses from Psalm 25. It says, O Lord, I give my life to you, I trust in you, my God. Show me the right path, O Lord, point out the road for me to follow. Lead me by your truth and teach me, for you are the God who saves me. All day long I put my hope in you. I just pray that for you, Anne.
I wasn't sure if I should get up and say something. Got a moment to. Hannah. Little H. I've known you since you were a bump. And then I was there when mum and dad brought you home. With a thick shock with dark hair. And it's been a joy to watch you grow into the wonderful young woman you are today. I've been quite overwhelmed this morning, but I'm happy for you. And it's been wonderful to be among friends, and friends like this for family. So.
Thank you. Anybody else have a word or a picture that they'd like to share for Hannah? Brilliant. Brian, thank you.
It's from Ezekiel 47. He led thee through the waters of Abraham deep. He measured off another 1,000 cubits, and then went through the water that's knee-deep. He measured off another 1,000 cubits, then through water that was wasting. I think what the Lord is saying to you, as you go through your Christian life, you have so much for you, until you come to water that you can't cross. He said, then look and you will see me. There's never a place that's going to be too deep for you. There's always going to be space for God. Don't think that you can do it on your own. He will be with you all the time of your Christian life. And when the water gets too deep, trust Him. Trust Him.
I have 2 John 1, verse 5. And now, dear lady, I am not writing to you a new command, but one we have had from the beginning. I ask that we love one another. I know that you are a loving person, and I know you will do a good job of loving you. Amen.
Hannah, you just demonstrate the joy of the Lord this morning, and I thank you for your bubbly personality. And when you're at the front, you go, Hannah's there. Bless you this morning.
Brilliant. We're going to stand and we're going to worship now. The first song we're going to sing in Christ Alone is Hannah's choice of song, and then we're going to continue to worship. And our young people are going to go back to their respective groups. Thank you so much for joining and sharing with us this morning.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, his solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, where fears are stilled, where striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross that Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. The ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, yet bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. No power of hell, no scheme. Nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. Life tasted and seen. Sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes clean, now my shame is undone. presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are God. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. Your presence. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my chains become undone. Your presence. Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence.
And we're just going to stay in that moment of worship, asking the Holy Spirit to be with us, to hold us and to keep us, to continue to encourage us and to fill us, to heal us, to strengthen that relationship that we have with our Lord and with one another. Hasn't it been wonderful to hear the story of how each Bradley and Marcel and Hannah have come to a sense of being baptized today because of the encouragement of those around them, because of the love shown to them, being brought up in a Christian home, to making those steps of saying this is what we want for our lives too. God, you are absolutely amazing, the way you touch us and you hold us and you grow us. We thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen.
If she kept praying much longer, I was going to go and tap her on the shoulder to let her know that I was back. My goodness, I love baptism services, don't you? Can we do it again next week? That was fantastic. It's lovely to see you all. In case you haven't been warned, baptism services sometimes go on a little bit longer than the advertised normal finishing time, so please bear with us. My name's Paul. I'm one of the ministers here, and it's a real pleasure to be speaking today, having been a part of those three baptisms. Wonderful, you guys. Absolutely brilliant. Is Hannah back in yet? Oh, well, hopefully she'll catch up with us in a few minutes. Somewhere around 25 years ago, I made a firm decision. I decided that I was going to write a book. And I had a couple of different ideas in my head. They'd been going around for a while, and I decided that it was time to give it a crack. I was going to have a go at it and just see what happened, see whether it worked or not. I even wrote the opening sentence of my first novel. Somewhere around 15 years ago, the idea came back, and in a slightly different way, and I thought, again, I really would like to write a book, so maybe I ought to give it a go. And I actually wrote, 15 years ago, the first chapter of a Christian book that I was going to write. I was going to write a book about all-age worship, believe it or not. I wrote chapter one. 15 years later, I still haven't written chapter two, but I'll get around to it. The truth is that I have dozens of unfinished and unstarted, in some cases, projects. Things that I've decided that I will get around to one day. Because I am the world's worst procrastinator. And I come from a long line of procrastinators. Actually, that's not entirely true. I come in the middle of a short line of procrastinators, is the real truth. My dad is the most practical man I know. For most of my life, he would take it as a personal affront if anybody other than him opened a toolbox in his house. When it came to plumbing, when it came to woodwork, when it came to decorating, when it came to car maintenance, he would do it himself. Not always very quickly, but he would do it himself. I was probably about 4 years old when I was allowed up into our loft at home. And up in the loft, I saw an interesting looking cardboard box full of interesting looking things. There were multicoloured wires and various switches and things, and a bright blue box with a light on top, a bit like a police car. And at 4 years old, I said to my dad, "Dad, what is that?" And Dad said, "Well, son," actually Dad never said "well, son," but it sounds better if I say it that way, "well, son, that's our burglar alarm." And at 4 years old, that seemed quite reasonable. Burglar alarms were quite clearly cardboard boxes full of components, and that seemed perfectly sensible to me. By the time I was 10 years old, I'd started to smell a rat. And the next time I went up into the loft, I said to my dad, "Don't you need to do something with all the things in that box before they become a burglar alarm?" And he said, "I'll get around to it." When I was 16, we came back from a family holiday and the house had been broken into and we'd been robbed and we'd lost all sorts of things. And within a month, that box came down from the loft and the wires got connected and we had a burglar alarm. And I'm not getting at my dad, because the honest truth is I know that I do exactly the same thing. I'll get around to it. And we've got a teenage daughter, and there are regular conversations that include the phrase, "I'll get around to it, Dad." And maybe I should be a little bit more understanding with her, because the truth is, she comes from a long line of procrastinators. And we're about to meet another procrastinator in our Bible reading this morning. One of the things I love about Jesus is he could be really quite politically incorrect. He could be quite blunt. He just spoke as he saw. Listen to the way that he spoke to this man in Matthew chapter 8. When Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders to cross to the other side of the lake. Then a teacher of the law came to him and said, "Teacher, I will follow wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Another disciple said to him, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus told him, "Follow me and let the dead bury their own dead." I became a Christian when I was 17 years old. I'd believed in God all of my life. I'd grown up believing in God, but I was 17 before I did anything about it and made a clear decision that changed my life when I decided to follow Jesus. And when I made that decision, I had a couple of good friends who were Christians, and they gave me a Bible, and they gave me some reading notes, which basically told me a passage to read out of the Bible each day. And I remember going through the Bible, following those reading notes, and coming to this passage and thinking, "Whoa, Jesus, no, you can't talk to that man like that. I mean, that's mean. That's just unkind. You can't be like that with this poor man. He's just lost his father. And all he wants to do is to go home and organise a funeral. I mean, that's hardly unreasonable, is it? How can you be so unkind to this man?" And this is one of those occasions when knowing just a little bit about the culture in Jesus' time helps us a lot when it comes to understanding what was going on. Back in those days, when somebody died, they were actually buried nearly always the very same day. And it would have been unthinkable during that day for the son to be anywhere other than at home mourning with his family. And so what I thought was going on when I first read this passage was not what was going on. And there are two possibilities. One is that some Jewish people in those times, they had a practice where a year after a funeral, they would take the bones of the person that had passed away and they would rebury them. And it could have been that this happened during that year. But actually, far more likely is that the man's father was still alive and well. And what he was saying is, "I want to go home for now, and sometime in the future, when my parents have gone and I've fulfilled my responsibilities, secured my inheritance, whatever it was, then I will think about following you, Jesus." In other words, what he was saying to Jesus was, "I'll get around to it. I'll get around to it." Have you ever noticed how the demanding things in life have the ability to squeeze out the truly significant things in life? Have you ever noticed that? Seems to be a rule of life that there are things that are really, really important, you know, in a deep, life-changing way important. And there are things in life that are urgent, and they are almost never the same thing. It's true when couples get married. Most couples spend 10 times longer discussing what colour the decorations are going to be on their wedding day than they spend discussing how they're going to handle finances and how they're going to cope when they fall out and have a row. The urgent squeezes out the important. It happens when you have that long overdue catch-up with a friend that you really care about or a family member that you haven't seen for months, or let's face it, after the 2 years we've had, quite possibly years, and you finally get to spend some quality time with somebody who really matters to you, and your phone buzzes. And who knows? It's just possible that somebody on Facebook has tagged you in a meme. And the urgent squeezes out the really important. Don't look at me like I'm the only one that does that. Don't do that to me. And we do that with spiritual things as well. Today, you might be a committed Christian, or you might be like I was for 17 years of my life. You believe in God, and you think there's probably something out there, but you've not yet investigated it for yourself and really found out to the point that you're sure. You might be somebody who has loads and loads of questions about spiritual things, and about God and about this whole faith thing.
Or you might be someone who feels pretty sure that you don't believe any of it. Here's something that I think we can all agree on. If God is real, if there is a creator God who designed and made this entire universe, who designed and made you as an individual, and if he loved you and cared for you and has plans and desires for your life, and if he was actively trying to steer the path of your life away from paths that would do you harm and cause you hurt, and towards paths that would lead you to living life to the full in the way that he wants for you, and if he sent his son Jesus to live as the perfect human being and to show us how to live our lives in connection with that God who made us, and if that Jesus died on the cross taking with him all the baggage of everything we've ever done wrong and everything that prevents us from having a close relationship with God, and if he rose from the dead 2 days later with the news that because of his death and resurrection, the human race can be set free from everything that suffocates our relationship with God, and if that Jesus extended an invitation to you and said, follow me, that would be the most important fact in the universe. If that were true, it would be the most important fact in the universe and the most important fact in your life. More important than what job you get, more important than who you marry, more important than the size of your pay packet, more important than who wins the cup or what grades you get or who wins the next election or anything else. If that was true, it would be literally a matter of eternal importance. Of course, if it isn't true, it's all trivial and irrelevant. But if you can see even the slightest glimmer of possibility that it might be true, then finding out enough to make your own mind up in the way that these three guys who have stood up here and talked about their faith have made their minds up just might be the most significant thing you ever do. You see, there are people that have gone looking and found out and made their minds up and made a wholehearted decision to follow Jesus. And we've heard from three of them today, and it's been wonderful, hasn't it, to hear their stories, to hear the journey that God has taken each one of them on. Three different stories, but three stories of God breaking in to people's lives. And there are people who have gone looking and found out what they could and made their minds up that they absolutely, positively don't believe a word of it. And I may not agree with those people, obviously I don't agree with those people, but I do respect them because they've investigated it. They've found out. They've looked for answers to those questions. Have you ever noticed how the demanding things in life can squeeze out the really significant things in life? So many people go through their lives believing in the possibility of God. Yes, there probably is a God. He might be out there. I definitely believe something. But never finding out for sure. Oh, yeah, faith and God and Jesus and the meaning of life. I'll get around to it. Which is what I did until I was 17, but some of us, if we're honest, do it for much, much longer than that. I'll get around to it. And that's where I think Jesus was pretty blunt with this man in the passage I read. What he said was, don't get around to it. It's too important for that. Don't put it on the back burner. Don't assume that you'll look into it when you've finished your education or when the kids have grown up or when you've retired and got a little bit more time or some other time in the future. What Jesus was saying is the time is now. Like we sung a few minutes ago, this is the day. And if you know that you've put God on the back burner, if you've been saying to yourself, you know what, one day I'll get around to thinking a bit more seriously about faith. Yeah, I think there is something there, but one day I'll get around to it. I want to invite you to explore what really matters in life so you can make your mind up. I was talking to somebody really recently who has been a Christian for a number of years now, but his journey of faith started when he said to God, I'm going to give you 6 months. I'm going to go to church for 6 months and I'm going to see whether you seem to be real, because I'm just not sure, but I'm going to find out. I'm going to test it out and find out for myself. So he went to church for 6 months to find out and to see whether God turned out to be real, and he did. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. In other words, what the Bible means by that is, don't just take some preacher's word for it. Find out for yourself. It's too important to leave it. It's too important to say, I'll get around to it one day. So why not try it? Come to church for 6 months. Find out whether it's real or not. Come and debate the things we say at the front with us. Come and ask the questions that you want to ask. Come and just be and see whether it's true and whether it makes sense, or whether we're all just a little bit mad here. Find out. Find out for yourself. We won't sign you up or box you up or process you or rubber stamp you or ask you to take part or any of that stuff. Just come and find out. Or if you've got lots and lots of questions, we've got another Alpha course, which is what Bradley did and was really significant in his journey. That's a great place to come and ask your questions about Christianity and why Christians believe the things they do and why they do some of the strange things they do. And we'll answer the questions that we can, but sometimes the answer will be, we have no idea why we do that strange thing. But find out. It's too important not to. Or it may be that you've already made your mind up. It may be that you know that it's true and you have still been putting off doing anything about it. And maybe today is the day for you as well, if that's you. Maybe it's the day to finally make that decision that you are going to follow Jesus with all of your heart. Or maybe it's the day to decide that you are going to get baptized. We've got another service coming up in December, but we'll do it sooner than that if you want. We would love to baptize you if that's what God's been saying to you. Take it from the world's worst procrastinator. Don't leave it for one day, because it is far too important for that. Today is the day. Let's pray together, can we? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you that you spoke straight truth to people. You didn't beat about the bush. And that sometimes that included being quite blunt. And thank you for your words to that man, saying, don't put it off for one day. Today is the day to nail your colours to the mast. Today is the day to take some action. And I want to pray today for anyone that you've been speaking to through this service, that today is the day that they need to find out for themselves whether you are real. They've seen their friends, they've seen their loved ones stand up here and talk about you as a real part of their lives. And inside, they're not yet sure whether that's true or not. And I want to pray for those people, that you would help them to take the decisions they need to take to find out for themselves, to come to their own decision as to whether you are real and worth following or not. But Lord, I pray that they would not leave it for one day. And Holy Spirit, I want you to ask you to come and visit anyone here who knows that Jesus is the Son of God, who knows that Jesus died for their sins, who knows that it is real and it is true, and yet who is putting off making a life-changing decision to follow you with all their heart. And if that's you, I'm just going to lead you in a prayer right now of, I'm not going to ask you to do anything public, but I'm going to pray a prayer of commitment. And if that's you, just say amen at the end of it. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you came to earth to show us how to live. And I believe that you died so that I could be forgiven and so that I could be adopted into the family of God. And I believe that you rose from the dead so that I could be set free from everything that suffocates my relationship with God. And so I choose today to give my life to you. Not half-heartedly, Not in a one day I'll get around to it sense, but I am choosing today to make the decision to follow you. Would you fill me with your Spirit? Would you show me that my sins have been forgiven? And would you guide me day by day as I choose to live for you? Amen. Amen. And if you have prayed that prayer, and if that's the first time you've prayed that prayer, we would absolutely love to chat with you afterwards, because your life has changed today, if that's the case. And if you want to have a conversation about how you can go about getting your questions answered and finding out for yourself whether it's all real. I mean, either these three guys are bonkers, or there is a God that changes lives. There's no middle ground. If you want to find out about it, then do come and have a chat with us. We'd love to have that conversation. Am I handing back to you? I'll hand back.
See, we haven't rehearsed this. Thank you so much. Our service will be up on social media in the next couple of days or so. We'd encourage you to share it amongst your friends, family and acquaintances. There'll be coffee in the hall at the far end of the building. We'd encourage you to stay for a cup of coffee and chat with us. We're not taking up an offering, but there are a couple of baskets.